And then we served as chairs together. And at P&B, just like in a classroom, everybody sits in the same seats. And if somebody's sitting in your seat, you get really irritated, by the way. And Tim and I always sat next to each other. And we had another colleague who sat on the other side, and very often when someone would make a remark that we thought was a remark that perhaps a chair should know better, Tim would always, under his breath, make a very snarky comment. And those who know me know that I'm just as capable of that. So we would have a very grand old time at the way opposite end of the table from the president, lest she, you know, catch on and see us. But then, of course, there's a change in position. And Tim was actually the chair of the search committee when I became the dean. So here's this, you know, it's a very peculiar circumstance. Your good friend and colleague is now the person who's going to make a determination about, you know, your future career. So it's kind of fascinating to have all these aspects. But I think that there will be many laughs today because Tim enjoyed a good sense of humor. He enjoyed seeing the wry sides of life. And if you were his friend on Facebook, you got to hear these all the time. And of course, a day never went by after a certain point in time where we didn't hear about Zoe. So, you know, for those of us who knew him for a long time, felt close, it really is a loss. And I really agree that we need to laugh, we need to celebrate, and we need to remember that, you know, I felt I should quote something from the theater. So I don't know if I've changed for the better, but I've changed for good, thanks to Tim.
Thank you, Dean. We're going to watch a film right now of a picture collage that was put together wonderfully by Terrell Lynch. Thank you, Terrell, wherever you are. But before we do so, I am going to tell one short little story. Just shoot me now. Right before this started, I ran into somebody whose name shall be nameless, who I didn't realize was a student here. He works here. And I mentioned, are you coming to the memorial? And he realized, oh my goodness, I can't. He had to go do some other business thing. And he told me that he had Tim. And I said, really, you had Tim? He said, yes, I had a Shakespeare class with Tim. There were only five of us in the class. And Tim used to hold the class in his apartment. And we would meet once a week, and Tim would make us the most wonderful dinner, and we'd sit around on the couch and discuss Hamlet, and watch the movie Hamlet and discuss how it was different, and the adjustments that were made from the original script and things like that. And then we had dessert. And he goes, it was okay because we all agreed not to tell anybody. So earlier we had the symposium, and somebody mentioned that teaching at York is one of the premier things is for students when they graduate is the time that a teacher made all the difference in someone's life. And I can only think that Tim has had an extreme effect on so many people, and that's what we're celebrating today, and let's watch this video.
You're in for a pleasant surprise. I've wasted time, I've wasted me. So say I'm slow for my age, a late bloomer. Okay, I agree that I
wanna make magic. I wanna be bigger than I am. I wanna make people really care. Really give a damn.
Then you go
downtown, where the folks are broke. You go downtown, where your life's a joke. You go downtown, when you buy your jokes. Give you go home to Skid Row.
We're here with, you know, the famous Tim.
Peace out.
Fields and sound.
Coffee black, you learn to drink your whiskey neat.
We learn to take a shower cold and sleep on tired feet. We learn to order dinner in. We learn to send the laundry out. We learn how to amuse yourself.
So easy, always. Even when he was chair, you can bang on his door over here and bother him, and he'd never let you know you were bothering him. So, it's big shoes to fill, but the new chair, Margaret Ventresen.
And although I did take Latin in college, I had to Google this. Thank God for Google. And it means infallible.
What it means out of the Pope's chair.
It's killing me. Actually, I was interim chair while Tim was here, and he had made some promises that he obviously didn't keep because he left me. A good colleague, a fine man, an interesting person. We both arrived here as tenure track in 2000, and we both believed that we had landed at the right place. And he'd stay until the end. And I thought I would be able to not cry, but he's missed. And I wish I could see more of his files. So I knew what the heck he promised people. So I could try and keep those promises. So I'm so happy to see so many people here to celebrate his life. It's the kind of thing that our department is going to do from now on. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Margaret. And now, I believe I have actual words to say, but we are introducing the performance aspect of tonight's festivities. So what you're about to see are artistic ventures that Tim believed in for various reasons. And first, we have musical. Do you want to start? Are they coming on now? Okay, I'm just going to announce it. Let's see what happens naturally behind me. First is from Rent, one of the more famous ballads from Rent, One Song Glory. It speaks about the consequences of wasted opportunities, playing the role of Roger from musical Rent. Tasso Merculis performs One Song, only for one song only. Students Darrell Lynch and Benzi Pierce to come up and tell us a little bit about your experience with Tim. We have no idea what they're going to say.
Neither do we, actually.
Hi, everyone. Slide note is probably the hardest thing out of all the shows I've done. This is probably the hardest thing I've had to do. Be on stage four. Thank you, everyone, for making out tonight. to show love to a man that we deeply respected and loved. Tim was the calm and collected man who made you feel things weren't so difficult in the first place. He taught us many things. Discipline and taking things serious meant something more on stage and in life. And with the occasional joke and raised eyebrow of concern or sarcasm, he casually kept the attention of anyone in the room. Tim taught us all to love who we are and what we do. Just settling for good enough was never an option for him. And taking risks and reaching for scary and unfamiliar places, because how else will you grow on stage and in life? There was no better feeling than working at something hard enough just to see a rare look of approval on Tim's face, or the pride that you were able to accomplish something he knew that you could do all along. Even if you didn't believe in yourself, Tim did. I was lucky enough to be close to Tim in college, and I was lucky enough to call him a mentor and a friend after college. We shared a love of wine, empanadas, beer, and soccer. Awesome combination. But things just don't feel the same without him. And I'm forever grateful for Tim for a few things in my life. Allowing me to be Tio for Zoe, for letting me be a part of the few musicals at York, the first few musicals at York, and my first few plays at York as well. Taking a kid out of the rafters from being a stage and a light and sound op and actually putting him on stage is a lot of bravery if you ask me. And finally, for being by my side for some of the most important times in my life. I thank you, Tim, for everything.
So, I was supposed to write a speech, and then I saw Jarrell's, and then I remembered that Tim liked improv anyway. So there's only really two points that I wanted to make to even add on to what he eloquently said. The first, and I say this with no disrespect, in all my years here at York College, I never met anyone who said, man, I wanted to go to York all my life. And I say that because we came here with different stories, with different perspectives. A lot of us came here and didn't even know what we were doing here or where we're gonna go next. But Tim took us all in, turned us into family. And that's what you see here in front of you, just a bunch of family members missing one. And it's unbelievable that he was able to do that. Through his sincerity and through his passion and his love. And the second point, as I was trying to write my speech, there's just one phrase that kept coming into my head, and the phrase was like, diamond in the rough. You know, we take that phrase for granted, but I'm just kind of looking up into it, and when they're digging in these mines for diamonds, right, it's just going through rocks and pebbles, and when they actually find one, it really doesn't look like much. And when we walk through this Performing Arts Center, most of us in here look like those diamonds in the rough. We look like pebbles, we look like rocks, we look devalued, worthless. But Tim had this uncanny ability to see the diamond. I mean, it's easy to see it when it's polished. It's easy to see it when it's on a ring. But when you can see it in its rawest form and know the worth, that's unspeakable. And for many of us here, for us to be coming back here, and we're not just coming back as friends and family, we're coming back as dreamers, entrepreneurs, builders, creators. We're showing our worth now, but Tim was able to see it while we were still in our rawest form, and he let us know what we were worth. So that's all I wanted to add on to Jarrell's speech, and it means something sitting here under these lights, because there was a time where many of us thought we didn't belong under these lights, and Tim let us know that we did. Thank you.
And moving right along, easily one of the more touching musicals directed by Tim. Rent talks about life, death, and all the struggles in between. Performing final or finale B, the cast of Rent.
I want you to go and clean the hall. I'll show you why I need business. Sir, I'm sorry. You just look so funny.
Get out and go clean the hall. I've got quality company coming.
Now that's not funny. Your high-class mother is such a mess. It's an hour of scrubbing.
So I should just shut all the doors just so you don't have to clean anything?
I wish I could tell you to keep it and to let out. What do you think you're doing? Is this some joke? Do you want everyone in their dog laughing at you in that ridiculous outfit?
Only fools like you will laugh at me.
That's a joke. Everyone who knows you has been laughing at you for years. Now, everyone else can laugh at you too.
Who is everyone else?
Anyone who has more brains than you do. I don't know what's been happening. You turned our house into a circus. Every morning it's a new carnival. Fiddlers, drummers, singers, trumpeters. Our names are furious.
What she said. I can do the place clean for the money.
You talk too much, and too long, and too loud.
She speaks more sense than you do. And what are you taking dance lessons for at your age?
And that fool of fencing master who goes around breaking things with his sword.
Both of you be quiet. You can't understand anything.
I understand, and at least teachers teach me anything useful.
Except having an ass for himself.
Like ignorant alligators. I bet you don't even have any idea what you're speaking right now.
I'm speaking the truth.
No, that's not what I meant. I bet you can't tell me the words you are now speaking.
They're sensible ones.
No, not that easy. I mean the language I am speaking to you this very instant.
What?
What is it called?
You can call it whatever you like. I call it a waste of time.
A big waste of time.
It is prose, you ignoramus. Ignoramus? Sis?
Prose?
Yes, prose. Whatever isn't prose is poetry, and whatever isn't poetry is prose. Ha! Now you know what it means to be educated. And you? Do you know what you must do when you say you?
You?
Yes, that's right. What do you do when you say you?
What are you to?
Say you. Just try.
You want me to say you?
That's right, but what is it that you do?
I say you.
Yes, yes, but what do you do?
That's what she told me to. Of course she did.
You are both imbeciles. Look, you pout out your lips. Pout out your lips. And you bring your under jaw to your upper. You. See how I did that?
Ew. Oh.
Yes, and there's oh, ooh, ooh, and there's death, 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 and F. Obviously, you don't care to be educated.
Get rid of these ridiculous professors of nothing.
Especially that clumsy fencing master.
You don't respect the fencing master?
He can't hold a feather duster.
I'll show you. Now watch. When you do the cart, it is like this and the tears is like dust. That is the way never to be killed. Is that not clever? Now you try. I promise not to hurt you. You're not doing it right!
I heard you!
Yes, but you must wait until I parry!
Once again, you prove yourself you are a fool. A foolish man who wants to act like a blue-blood snob.
That only shows I have more sense than you and your bourgeoisie.
More memorable moments from Dreamgirls was when the men of the cast stepped to the bad side. Led by James Thunder Earl, played by Eric Carter, the males from the cast present Steppin' to the Bad Side.
Hey, to the point. You just gotta step into the past life. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Step into the past life.
Played by Gabrielle Colleg. has her dreams come true by leading the Dreamettes.
Pretend to care.
to be here today, but is studying for her master's. And now, getting back into the dramatic, is something that Tim did a lot of work on, exploring the Latino community and diversity in America. And to that end, one of the shows, which was so popular here, we had to actually set up an in-time visual display at 106 for the overflow, is from Yo Soy Latina. And here to give a monologue to two people from Yo Soy Latina is Linda Mendeville and Francis Madden.
Then fire me, I don't care, but let me remind you, I'm the only one that can speak English.
Yeah, I thought so. What? Just because you own a 1 in 5 dime store in the worst section of Brooklyn, think you dropped Donald Trump?
How are you gonna tell me? I take too many breaks.
Slave trade was over a long time ago, Mr. Manager. How you know? 5 and dime cashier? Anyway, yo soy una actriz, a future Latina star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. I'm telling you, once I get that call that's gonna change my destiny, I'm turning my back and I'm never coming back. That's keep your broken down Roach Motel tenements and drug infested ambitions. That's what I'm gonna yell about to you fools when I'm on that 747 to LA. LA, I like that. Imagine me, set la vida vida, in LA, the land of dreams, the place that people play lotto with their lives. I'm gonna be bigger than Jennifer Lopez, Rosie Perez, Raquel Welch, all put together. I'm gonna be so big that little white kids are gonna be just like me. Instead of the other way around, they're gonna wanna eat rice and beans, guanciale, eat chuleta. They're gonna wanna dance salsa y merengue. They're gonna wanna watch Sábado Gigante for 24 hours, like any other born Latino does on a Saturday night. I'm telling you, I'm gonna bring the whole world on being Latino.
It's our turn now. Our turn to show the world that we're not just little book people trying to get you right. We got power in our numbers. By the year 2050, Latinos are gonna rule the world. Well, maybe not rule, but we will be occupying a hell of a lot of space. We're gonna be able to pick up a phone book in Wichita, Kansas, and find a million one Rodriguez's. You're gonna find Mexicans, Dominicans, Cubans, Dominicans, South Americans, on every inch of this planet. We're gonna be everywhere. They're gonna have to make up the primetime television lawyers and doctors on those who visit comes instead of the Spanish-speaking maintenance men. I wanna see my face on the TV set for a change. I wanna see my olive skin gracing the covers of Vogue and Elle magazine. I want to see my arroz con pollo thighs inside this orphaned sweaty swimsuit issue. Not some skinny little wave and bone sticking out of her back that calls herself a supermodel. Let Kate Moss walk to Orchard Beach in the middle of July without getting laughed at. Then Vito Lena, put some clothes up. Look like a human wishbone. What's a body without thighs? Without a little bit of sofrito, huh? Yo soy Latina, I'm proud of it, baby. Nobody's gonna make me feel like an ugly duckling because I'm not an anorexic girl, believe me. This is my body, my face. Take it or leave it. And that's what I'm gonna say to Steven Spielberg, and I beg of you, my energy like that. Why? Because I'm not gonna be afraid to be me. That's right, I'm gonna give my people what they've been wanting for a long time. A chance to see themselves, a chance to feel good about themselves, a chance to free themselves from Brady Bunch reruns. That's right, I watched that show for years thinking I have the worst parents on the planet. I never saw Mrs. Brady take a chancleta to Marsha's head. I asked Mommy why she didn't act like Mrs. Brady, and you know what she said? She said, if you don't like the way we live around here, then I take your father with you.
So for years after that, I fantasized about being a white child in the Brady Bunch house. I pictured Bobby coming home, sitting me on his lap and telling me how much he loved me and how proud he was of me just being his daughter. and that no matter what I decide to be when I grow up, he will love me regardless. And then, bam! Reality hits you square in the face because, the truth of the matter is, there is no really much existence for Latinos. 40 million strong, and we're still playing the extra in a drug-free America public service announcement instead of a principal in an Ivory Soap commercial.
Case my ass. I have the power to be me, not you. I will always be a proud Latina so that my future son or daughter can grow up confident, self-assured, and proud. So that they can carry on my love for this beautiful culture of ours, this wonderful array of gifts that have been passed down from our ancestors. A language filled with stone-colored words, exotic books that feed the hunger of the soul, and music, music that makes you stand up and yell, I am proud to be a Latina.
Custom-made gifts that some of us throw away for the sake of being accepted into a culture much colder, much less passionate than ours. A culture that looks at our gifts with a sigh of disgust for the fear that it'll bring down the value of our communities.
Don't move into our neighborhoods. We don't want you here. Unless, of course, you look like us, you act like us, you become us. Forget your past. Join our club. It's free membership. All you gotta do is strain your blood so there are no traces of history left. Forget where you come from. This is your home now. What more can you ask for?
Well, Lisette de Villa Rivera just wants to feel like she's home. That's what I want. I don't want to have to worry if I'm sitting in my backyard listening to the timbas and congas while on the radio while Willie Colon, Mark Anthony, and Tito Nieves make love to me with their voices. I don't want to have to hide my multicolored family from your homeowners association. Theo Hector and Dia Juanita can't help the African, Indian, European blood that runs through their veins.
And neither can I.
Let me be who I need to be.
A proud Latina.
Will you let me do that?
And now, from Aida, Dance of the Robe, with the role of Aida being played by Maya Bass.
Nothing less will do. So, Conductor Purdue, Maestro, please give us a vamp.
Solomon Peck.
request.
No request.
I know the prisoners must die for crimes against Egypt.
That is the law. But I ask that the traitors be allowed to die together.
But that would be mercy, after they disgraced you in front of the entire nation.
I was wronged. It should be my decision.
You don't know your own mind. For their crimes.
Your Majesty! There is poison in your blood. We both know this. Soon I will be completely alone because everyone I love will be gone. So you must allow me to exercise my will over Egypt. Because I will. Because I demand it! For their crimes, the prisoners will be buried beneath the sands of Egypt in one tomb, together. The daughter of Isis has spoken.
We all lead such elaborate lives, wild ambitions in our sights. How an affair of the heart survives days apart and hurried nights seems quite unbelievable to me. I don't want to live like that. Seems quite unbelievable to me. I don't want to love like that. I just want to keep. We all live in extravagant times, playing games we can't all win. Unintended emotional crimes take some out. Tear us apart.
thing more to announce. It says announcement. And then the finale, but not really the finale, because then we ask you all to please exit and partake in cookies, coffee, apple juice, and it's all from the provost budget. Thank you very much. Good actors, and what people don't eat, please grab the And now the announcement. Thank you, the York College Scholarship Office. I went to them in December, and they said, no problem. And sure enough, if you look in your program, there is an insert with a website. And back in my day, you could not leave your apartment without your keys and at least $10 in case something happened and you had to get home. Nowadays, of course, you don't leave without your keys, your cell phone, and a credit card. So I know everyone here has a credit card and a cell phone, and that means before you leave here tonight, you will be able to connect to the website that you see there and possibly donate to the new Timothy J. Amrhein Theater Arts Scholarship. For theater arts students who are awarded the scholarship through their letter describing their passion for theater and their financial need to handle books, other expenses of tuition, and living expenses. It's for two students, $1,000 each. And yes, I am optimistic. I would like to see it a perpetual scholarship. We would need by next spring $65,000 to do that. If not, then please give every year and we'll be able to make that award. That's my dream anyway. Take it with you. I have one other thing. Yes, and if you can't send by cell phone, you can write a check, and I have these here. There was something I wanted to say, but I can't remember. So now, ladies and gentlemen, the finale from Rent. Thank you all so much for being here.
Thank you.
Outside and have some